small, because that was the line that was used to create a television series, All Creatures Great and Small. But let us sing as joyfully and as lustily as we can, in memory of Mary, all things bright and beautiful. Participant with God. And the message of Solomon in this lesson couldn't be more
worst things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." This is the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel is written in the Gospel according to St. John. Please stand. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God still, and trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's take comfort in your memories and be thankful. Be thankful that you have been part of this long, full life. Be thankful that you have been blessed to be part of this strong, loving family. Be thankful that you have made some precious memories along the way. On one level, in some way, Miriam, the love that you had for everyone kept you tied for the world, to the world, for over 100 years. In return, the love everyone feels for you was strong enough to keep you from going. And in the end, in his love, Jesus Christ released you from your physical burdens, took your hand, and walked with you to your new home. So we gather today to bid farewell to a beloved woman. And three things remain. The faith that the love of Jesus Christ will rule our lives. The hope and promise of our reunion. The certainty that this was not goodbye, but only goodnight. And finally, we are left with the love that we have for Miriam. The love Miriam has for us. And the love that we have for one another. And the love that God has for all of us in Jesus Christ. No matter what, God promises to be with us and in death to hold us in his loving arms. We know and believe that there is no better place to be than in the arms of Jesus, safe in his loving arms, where he holds Miriam and us in love. Let Christ's love surround you, because love never fails. May she rest in peace.
And now let us stand and express our belief in some of the basic doctrines of faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God.
Thank you.
or Granny as she always was to me, was a massive part of my life. She and Grandad lived in the house right next door to ours, and it was like a second home, with the house always being affectionately known as Granny's house. Such was her endearment to us, and much to the amusement of poor Grandad. I have so many wonderful childhood memories spent there, from Christmas days at Granny's, complete with games after dinner, despite doing turkey and all the trimmings until well into her late 80s. The rare treat of staying at her house after school, her famous sugar sandwiches, her delicious brown bread, and her legendary apple tarts. When I think of Granny now, I remember her joy coming out for lunch with us at Kilsunny every Sunday, her delight when I would come through the door for a chat, her determination to go walking up the road unassisted in later years, despite being warned not to. I think also of her sharp mind, her gentle smile, her trusty black handbag, and her dozens of skirts that all looked the same to me but were carefully classified into everyday and good wear. I think of her in the kitchen baking bread or stoking up the fire with a few slabs of turf, or in her usual queue in Kilsyth Mullen, third up from the back on the left-hand side, immaculately turned out and usually the first to arrive. But most of all, I best remember Granny comfortably seated in her favourite armchair by the fire, reading the paper or having a cup of tea in the place where she was most content, her home in the poppies. Granny was a powerhouse of a woman and a real one of a kind. She had an opinion on everything, didn't like the word no, wasn't afraid to be in disagreement with you, and she had the ability to say a lot without saying anything at all. She was a stickler for routine and order, and was a ferocious timekeeper. She was ultra-organized, meticulous in all she did, and was active beyond her years, right up until almost the very end. She was fiercely independent, so much so that at the ripe old age of 99, she took to hiding her walking frame in the turf shed, lest anyone suggest she actually used it. She was optimistic almost to a fault, never complaining, with her can-do attitude something that I always admired in her. She had a real joy for life and truly appreciated every single new day as a blessing. She never missed a Sunday in Kilsyth Mullen, attending her last church service there just 2 days before she was admitted to hospital for the final time. She was a simple woman in the best sense of the word, a true homebird, happiest in Tobey, at the heart of her family. She was an exceptional grandmother and was absolutely besotted with her grandchildren and great-grandchildren, never missing a birthday, often a week early with birthday cards, such as her style, and generous with both her praise and encouragement, as well as her presents and gifts. She took a real interest in what everyone was doing, from college to work, boyfriends and girlfriends, who would be home at the weekend or next to visit, and all the comings and goings that daily family life entails. Her love of family also went further afield, and she took great pride in the sprawl of the extended Woods family tree, boasting encyclopedic knowledge of family connections in Australia, South Africa, the UK, America, and beyond. Her own parents, Richard and Jane, were born in the 1800s, and Granny was almost as old as the Irish Republic itself. She only just missed World War I, and there was little she didn't see or few challenges she didn't face in her 100 years. She was the youngest of 18 children and the first of her family to get the opportunity to go to boarding school. She trained and worked as a teacher, had a career in means of her own, which was a feat in itself for a woman in those days. She faced the choice between marriage and family and keeping her job as a teacher, something that is practically inconceivable for her granddaughter sitting here today. She married and had 5 children, moved to Tobey and helped alongside Granddad to create from just a few acres and 4 cows, the farm that is still in operation to this day, and the livelihood that has sustained 3 generations over the past 70 years.
and she herself buried a newborn son in the 1950s, at a time when bereavements were handled very differently in the Ireland of that era. She lost her husband in 2008 after nearly 60 years of marriage, and it is all the more remarkable in today's world to appreciate the longevity of a relationship that spanned nearly six decades. When I think of the soft-spoken, kind-hearted, gentle lady that I always knew Granny to be, it's hard to fully appreciate all that she experienced and lived through in her century of life. Granny was blessed to live a long, full, and happy life, but really it was all of us who were blessed to have her at the helm of our family for so long. She will be forever missed, and may she now rest in peace. Amen. While I'm here, I would like to say a few thank yous on behalf of the family. First, to Canon Ian for such a lovely and moving service, and for all your kind words, prayers, and support over the last few weeks particularly. Also, sincere thanks to Monsignor Dewey for being here with us today, and also to Hazel for her beautiful organ playing, which added so much to today's service. I also want to mention Canon Tom Sherlock, who would have been Grogan here with us today if circumstances were different, and a sincere thanks to both Tom and his wife Hazel for all their friendship to Granny over many, many years. Thank you also to Eamon and the staff at Grace Funeral Home, who took such dignified care of Granny in preparation for her final journey. Thank you to the doctors and nurses at Templemore Medical Centre, the staff at Murphy's Pharmacy, the palliative care team and the district nurse, who played such a big role in the final weeks of Granny's life, keeping her comfortable right up until the very end. A special word of thanks to Granny's primary carer, Michelle. To say Michelle went over and above in her care for Granny would be an understatement. It was such a comfort for us to have you at Granny's side, and she herself thought the world of you. Thank you. Thank you also to Patricia and Teresa, who also provided much needed and gratefully appreciated care for Granny as well. Thank you to you both. Thank you to our wonderful neighbours in Debay, who dug and prepared the grave for burial. Thank you also to John and Robert, who have always maintained the graveyard in Clifford Mum so well, and for their extra efforts over the last few days in preparation for today. All of our own family did their utmost to look after and care for Granny in her final months. It was a massive team effort, and every single person played their part in giving Granny the love and support she deserved when she needed it most. On the passing of Grandad, Henry stepped up to become a de facto second husband for Granny, and was by her side in everything that she did. It is fair to say that Granny could never have lived such an independent life for so long, well into her 101st year, without Henry's help. Sandra flew home from Holland at a moment's notice to help Granny convalesce after her various short spells in hospital, staying for weeks at a time as we approached the end. Richard was only ever a phone call away, and always tended to the family grave in Kilfith Mow, which brought Granny so much comfort. My own father, Trevor, kept the farm thriving and provided for Granny in more practical but just as meaningful ways. And it was my own mother, Louise, who has been at the forefront of Granny's care over many years, handling everything that came her way with good humour, patience, and energy. I know Granny thought of you as like a second daughter, and knowing how much family meant to Granny, I can't think of any higher compliment than that. Apologies to anyone I've left out, and thank you also to everyone who sent us cards, called, texted, visited the house, baked, helped on the farm, and supported us in any way. Thank you. It is so humbling to see so many people here today and also yesterday to pay their respects to Granny, and it means so much to us all. Granny hated being the centre of attention, but today has been a loving celebration and a fitting farewell to an extraordinary life and legacy. I hope we can always continue
listening to all of that will feel that you certainly have done my memory proud. Our next hymn, which I would ask you to stand while we sing, is How Great Thou Art. And this was written by a Swedish poet called Carl Borg. And he wrote the words, and then he used a Swedish traditional melody for the hymn. That was that. Then someone heard it and translated it to German. Someone then brought it to Russia and translated it in Russia. An English missionary heard it in Russia, translated it to English, and that's how we have it. He added his own verses to it. So now, let us, after all of that, it just shows that you can't keep a good tune down. So let us do justice to the tune by singing How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
and spirit. We want you to heal and remove everything that is causing stress, grief, and sorrow in our lives. Please guide our path through life and make our enemies be at peace with us. Let your peace reign in our family, at our place of work, our businesses, and everything on which we lay our hands. Let your angels of peace go ahead of us when we go out and stay by our side when we return. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord, for all your gifts, the sunlight bright and warm, the winter snow and the summer rain that help us in the garden. Thank you for the mild spring days, so perfect for planting seed, and send a little rain our way, you know how much we need. Protect our crops in the field from the raging storm, and fill the stalks with golden yellow corn. Please help us too at harvest time to gather in the yield, the blessings of your bounty from a thankful farmer's field. Amen.
Amen.
God of all consolation, help us to comfort one another in our grief, finding light in time of darkness and faith in time of doubt. We pray for all those we have loved who have died. Give them the reward of their goodness. We pray for those who care for the sick and dying, especially those who care for Miriam during her last few months. We pray for those here today that our memory of Miriam, whom we loved, inspire us with a renewed love for all our sisters and brothers. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Father in heaven, we praise your name for all who have finished this life loving and trusting you, for the example of their lives, the life and grace you gave them, and the peace in which they rest. We praise you today for your servant Miriam, and for all that you did through her. The sadness we feel today, we can afford to hold close, safe as we are, in the knowledge that grief is love's echo. We just have to listen, and it's there. Meet us in our sadness, and fill our hearts with praise and thanksgiving, because we know we cannot feel sadness without first feeling love. Amen. Our prayers conclude when we say together, Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. See why. So let us sing, Abide with Me.